What's going on, Spittin' Chiclets fans? Biz here, and thanks for tuning in to the first edition of the ECHL Player Relief Fund interview series, brought to you by Boikies. What is Boikies, you ask? Boikies is a delicious air-dried beef biltong. It's a healthier version of jerky, made in the USA with high-quality ingredients. More protein, half the sodium, and zero sugar. Not only does Boikies make an amazing product, but they have been generous enough to donate $10,000 to the ECHL Player Relief Fund and will be offering fans a Biz20 promo code for any product on the Boikies.com website. We know times are not easy right now, so we're trying to give you as much content as we can. So we hope you enjoy this interview, and please stay safe. And once again, thank you to Boikies.
We are now joined by a good friend of mine. This makes me very excited, very happy to talk to a guy who many people listening may not know a ton about.
Well, no shit.
Little bit of a
chirp. Suitcase.
But let me tell you before we start this thing, this suitcase played 4 years at Minnesota Duluth, 160 games roughly 160 points. How's that for stats? Before they won a national title. Sorry about that. He then went over to Finland and he lit it up in Helsinki for a couple years and then comes back and plays up and down AHL, NHL before going back over to Russia and the KHL, Switzerland, Sweden, and then finishes in Germany with over a point per game in his last year. Thanks for coming, Tim Stapleton. Thanks for joining the podcast, buddy.
Thanks for having me.
I think we gotta
open this podcast up with "I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere."
He really has. So the first time that you were gonna meet up with us and do this interview was at our disaster of a live show last year in Chicago, where there was no volume, there was no audio, we couldn't figure it out. So I said, we'll come back, and you said, I want to do this in person, so it's a pleasure to finally have you, dude. How you been?
Good, and that's funny, that time, because you just called me on the spot, because you did Reed Simpson.
Yes.
And I'm fucking, you brought me in.
Like, I go, hey, bud, I need you.
Yeah, you were like talking about, you know, and I was sitting there with Reed. This was actually funny for me, because I was like nervous, and I'm like, Reed's sitting there, and we're standing in the crowd, and I'm like, Reed, you know what you're going to say? And he's like, no, not really. And then like 2 minutes later, he was like Ron Burgundy. He pulled out a sheet.
Yeah, he had a
million
notes.
He had all the fucking stories. I'm like, but thank God the mics broke because I had no idea what I was going
to
say.
Yeah, you were like, I need to prepare for this interview. I need to prepare. All right, so dude, it's been 2 years since you retired, right?
Yeah.
So what's been going on and why did you stop playing? I mean, it's like you were fucking buzzing around. It seemed like you could play forever. Was it just I'm sick and tired of playing hockey?
Yeah, kind of. Also, I had my second child, my daughter.
Congrats.
Thank you. And
on the sex?
Yeah. It works, I guess. But no, I just, it was just time to quit. And then I started a South African beef jerky company.
So this was sent to my house, and it's legit. I'm going to tell everyone. We got pictures over here, but is Boikies the correct way to say it?
Yeah, Boikies.
What kind of meat is this? What are the animals we're eating here?
It's a beef product.
Ooh. It's not squirrels with feathers?
No.
It's a real feathered squirrel.
I thought squirrels had feathers recently. Not my brightest moment. So how's that going? I mean, is it like, because you're trying to hop into something after hockey, it's tough to be like, what am I going to do now, right?
Yeah, no, it's, I got offered my business partner is a guy, Chicago guy. He's an older guy named Jim Mullins. Private labeled sauce for all the McDonald's. So they make all the ketchup and barbecue
sauce.
Oh,
they're doing all right then.
Yeah, and they sold that company. He lived in South Africa. The biltong is actually the curing process, and it's just air-dried as opposed to cooked. And it's really healthy. No sugar.
Yeah.
30% more protein
and tasty.
Yeah, it's
shit.
32 grams of protein.
Tasty,
pass me a bag
tasty.
Over.
Yeah, try it out.
All right, I'm sitting this interview out. I'm just going to mock some.
Anyways, thanks for having me, guys.
Of course.
All right, so, that ad was brought to you by
Boikies.com.
All right, and then I'm like, why are you still here, dude? Yeah. Interview's over.
Where does South Africa come into it?
So he, Jim lived out there in the early 90s. McDonald's hired their family to open up a plant out there to make sauce. Have you guys eaten at Nando's?
Oh,
no?
Yeah.
So
I played in England. I lit up the
They developed peri-peri sauce for all that company, and that's basically the chili. Not many people know what that is. But he lived out there for like 8 years, 7 years.
Did he like it there?
Yeah, he loved it.
I heard it's incredible.
He doesn't stop talking about it.
Have you gone?
I have not gone yet, yeah.
Have you seen District 9?
No.
Oh, it's great fucking South Africa. It's like the best South Africa movie. Anyways.
Really?
Anyway, oh, yeah, it's a science fiction movie about a spaceship.
You ever heard of science fiction? I'm not into
it. Who is it? Dart Antwoord or something? Art Antwood. There's a South African rap group. You gotta know who the fuck that
yeah,
is. Me.
South
yeah,
African.
Ari fucking knows the South African
rap. South rap group.
Yeah.
I think it's our Die Antwoord's the name, and it's a girl and guy. They're a rap group out of South Africa. So you don't know much history other than the fact that they make great beef jerky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's probably just as well.
Yeah, that's all I do know. I mean, that's all. Yeah, you're right. But I don't know much about South Africa besides the biltong. Well.
yeah, this guy's so,
knows
already.
Their flag.
So yeah, no, but Jim just kind of, it was his idea, and then he just asked me to.
No, it's because I mean the logo. It's definitely an eye catcher, man. You know, yeah. It's not something you see too often.
Dude, born and raised right outside Chicago, correct?
Yeah,
Forest Park,
10 miles west. Yeah.
So, like, you're a year older than me, 37 now, I believe you are.
Yep.
So, what was youth hockey like around here? I can't imagine it was that good growing up at like 12, 13, or were you just traveling so much?
It was all right. It just wasn't, you know, since the Hawks been doing good, it's really good. But I mean, I met my agent at a Rad Hockey, which is like you pay open hockey, you pay like $10 and
like just go.
Yeah, that's how I met my agent, and Bill Zito, who's like the assistant.
What, GM. He was skating or he?
Yeah,
was...
he was skating. He's like, you're kind of
he's like a client.
He's like, you're not bad, huh? Yeah. You're like, yeah, dude.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, yeah. That's basically how it happened. How I met him, and then.
So you would go skate. Just
that was
open
at like
ice?
15. Yeah, open ice, and
that was
time.
That before you were with the Green Bay Gamblers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this is
and,
before.
And then did he get you to Green Bay?
I don't know. That's a good question. I don't think so.
Like you were just like
I was just
drafted probably in the USHL.
Yeah,
I bet.
I was just kind of good.
Did you?
Yeah, right, you guys don't bring shitty players on here, do you?
Yeah. No, we just host them.
Everyone's still everyone's still trying to Google and figure out who the fuck I am. But
I was we got Mike Stapleton.
He's 5'7" and Asian. This doesn't make sense.
I don't know if half Filipino, half Irish, or is Wikipedia.
Oh, worst driver ever. The Asian in him. He can't drive a car. He gets driven everywhere.
And he's probably drunk with the other half of the Irish.
Yeah. Yeah, my mom, brother, and sister were born in the Philippines.
No shit, huh? Yeah.
Really?
And, yeah.
Your brother play hockey?
Yeah, a little. Well, just
yeah,
when we were
but
young.
But he played growing up.
Yeah.
So when you went to Duluth, were you a big recruit then? Like, were you getting offers from a lot of people?
No, it was the only school I looked at.
And you ripped
well,
it up.
I was just like,
I know,
free.
I know you got so buckled on your official visit and committed the next morning.
Yeah. But. No, yeah, it was the only school. I didn't really know much about hockey, to be honest. Like, I wasn't.
So you weren't a kid that was like really into like.
I was good when I was like 8, and no, seriously though, and then kind of when I was like 16, I started playing AAA, and that's.
And that's when you kind of started getting noticed.
I just it was kind of a fluke, I think. I don't know.
All right, so 4 years at Duluth and some really good years. Like I said, I mean, you know, 42 points your freshman year. That was probably. Guessing that was the year before. Oh, I think we were freshmen the same year. Either way, I'm guessing that was probably top five in the country for freshmen. I'm sure you have no idea, but you lit it up for 4 years. And the question being, you never got drafted, but you went right over to Finland. And it's a lot of times people try playing here, and when they can't make the NHL, they go over there. You did it from the start. How did that like all even come about and begin?
That was my agent for sure.
Yeah,
he like kind of built his agency around like getting. No name guys, really. So he had like Rafalski that went over to Finland. He had
same team, right?
Same team. Yeah,
he was on Jokerit.
And then he has Tim Thomas, Ville Leino, who's a Finnish guy. But then he's got
this guy should be a fucking scout, is what
well,
she should
he's
be.
He's assistant GM now of Columbus.
Oh, well, that'll do it.
And that's what he always said. That, yeah.
Or that
gonna one up the whole scouting gig. But no, and that's funny you say that because the entire time I had him for like 14 years, and the entire time he was saying he wanted to be a GM, and
he's like, I'm going to get this done.
That's how talented this guy is. He can seek talent out of, like, no offense,
out of a
5'7 Philippine men's league guys. Like, that's fucking talent, bro. That is like, come on, man.
Yeah, that's true.
This guy should be working for the Red Wings back 20 years ago.
This guy crashed his car trying to park in the parking lot, but God, he can skate.
What? Like, couldn't pass a driver's test.
Now, like, you were... Like, you would say you guys are friends, right? Like, he's, like, you're very close with him, right?
Yeah. No, I am, but I don't talk to him as much
Naturally, but I'm saying at the time you leave Duluth, were you not like, I can't get anything over here? Or was he more like, dude, go here first. Go to Helsinki.
He was, because in that time it was, like, Tuukka Rask was in the league and a couple other Antti Niemi. So these goalies were obviously attracting a lot of scouts.
They're there. They're watching.
And I was trying to do the whole, you know, men's league thing like I did, just trying to catch someone's eye. And that's honestly, I had no intentions to play back over here. Like when I went there, like
you're I'm gonna go play in Europe.
Yeah,
for,
I was just like
10 years.
Yeah, I was just I'll go.
Finland's easy to live. I'm sure you're enjoying yourself.
100%. And then it just kind of, you know, felt, you know, happened.
So. Well, when you say it kind of happened, I mean, you lit it up. You go over there, and the first year you get 50 points in 56 games, and the next year you get 62. You get almost 29 goals. It must have been like, all right, all of a sudden, all these teams are calling me. Zito's like, dude, people want to sign you back home. Is that kind of how it went?
No, not at all.
Really?
No, it's Ville Leino was my line mate. And he went to Detroit.
Heard some funny stories about that guy.
I don't know. I don't know what he's doing now. He's like
he had a clothing
He's
line.
Like a painter
living
or something.
Living off that Buffalo money.
Was yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's still from Buffalo. Well,
good for him. I would.
Yeah, hey, fuck right. Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah,
we'll play his podcast. Play his podcast. Yeah, paid.
No, he... Toronto was the only team, really. And that's why I signed with. Pittsburgh was interested, but Toronto at the time just gave me like a bigger signing bonus, which...
But why you were like, I'm gonna
That's
go
the only
a
reason
shot?
I played hockey was for money.
Hey, dude, I seen all the
I'm
years
not
you
lie.
Played in Europe. No. Like, yeah, you were there to make no. fucking money. I don't blame you.
No, it's it was just and that's just kind of how it worked out. But no, I didn't really. I signed actually back in Finland for 2 more years.
What was
put the NHL out?
What was your first impression of pro hockey back in North America? Because I mean, you go from playing a pretty fair schedule to now all of a sudden you got to work for your money. You got to grind through a 80-game season in the American League.
Well, I played 9 games. Or
I was
going to
say you before Finland, you were in Poland, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that was just a waste of time.
You're probably so mad you didn't get to do senior spring at the.
It was just like, I sucked
AHL.
Too. I was just like, didn't. Yeah, you're right. And I was like, we were on a team with like, it was a great team. It was like Gillies, Konopka. You know, and I'm coming from college wearing like a full cage, and then. You know, I'm going to these guys who were...
Oh, Konopka was a savage,
man.
Too.
It was. I remember my first game, I was in warm-ups, and I forgot two guys were just fucking barking all warm-ups, like, oh, they're going to kill each other. I'm sitting there stretching, like, what the fuck is this? You know what I mean? Like,
Konopka was probably the guy.
You know, and then
no refs on the ice?
No, and I'm like, dude, this is fucking brutal. So I was skating off after warm-ups, and both guys kind of like... We, you know, at Portland, they had the one door. I'm like, oh, God, like, what's going to happen here? And both guys were just like, hey, I'm not even playing tonight. They were like the extras in warm-ups. Then I was like, what the fuck is going on here? Like, you know what I mean? You know, it was just like, it was a
sideshow.
Yeah, I was just like, what is this, you know?
So Penner and O'Brien were on that team, too?
Yeah, oh, Penner was God. There. Who's Obi?
Obi, yeah.
Yeah, Obi was there. And they, they were great, though. I mean, I didn't really say much, but I followed.
Couple yeah, of that characters. Was a little stint.
Yeah, I was an Indian, not a chief in that moment. Just whatever. I was a yes man.
Just tell me what to do.
Yeah.
I'll do whatever you say.
Yeah. Who else recruited besides our Minnesota Duluth?
Nobody.
No, I mean, yeah, nobody.
Sorry, no, that was, so that was it.
Of
it was
nobody.
Either, it was either legit go there or no.
I committed right away.
Oh, wow.
And for me, it was more like I got a full ride, which I was very grateful for, and I just wasn't. It worked out.
Fooled him again.
Yeah. Fooled him again, you know, so.
Yeah. Ah, that's cool, man. That's cool.
You know, it was, yeah.
Okay, so since you're so fucking modest, that first year, well, the first full season back in North America with the Leafs, you end up playing 4 games. Playing your first NHL game. I mean, like, okay, now what? What fucking crazy story do you have for us now?
Who'd you tuck against, too? You had one goal that year.
Yeah, the one goal was...
Hit you in the face
and
going...
No, I did. I didn't
talk us through your first game. Was it a call-up and right away?
The call-up was awesome. Yeah, no, seriously, I was... it was like February. My agent called me. He's like, hey, I'm coming in for dinner. And at the time, like, the Leafs were...
And you were lighting up the A.
Yeah, and the Leafs were mathematically, like, basically out of the playoffs. Okay. They were fucking pretty bad. So we went to dinner.
And you still couldn't make the team.
Yeah. Fuck, you should have seen my preseason. I played one game... And my line was me, Jamal Mayers, and Chris Newberry.
You had no chance.
I played 4 minutes, and then the next day, Ron Wilson was like, hey, you're not ready for North. I'm like, what? Like,
wait, I got one game? You
know, I was like, all right, I got the shower with the guys. So, you know, I was like, fucking, you know, I mean, whatever. But
got a little per diem.
Yeah, I was like, fuck. When I went to this dinner... You know, I was actually kind of bitching. Like, I was like, hey, am I going to get an NHL game?
Yeah, I'm lighting up the AHL.
Kind of. Not like I should have been, you know.
But, like, you're seeing other guys maybe get called up
I was just like, am I going to get one game? Like, this is, I never thought
I know,
I'd get
I came
this
home
close.
From... maybe get a game.
Like. And then my agent, I got called up right there, like within like 5 minutes.
Oh, he shot off a text?
No, it's just like the game was on. It was right next to the Air Canada Center. I don't know. I think that's
Real
the
Sports?
Name.
That place?
No.
Remember that restaurant?
Yeah.
Place with money.
It was a strip club, the Brass Rail. Yeah. They were grabbing a couple of whiskeys.
And no, it was just so like someone went down and they called me up right there after like 5 minutes. Like literally
you
mid-conversation.
Said that to him. 5 minutes later, yeah, injury, fact, five and then his phone gets...
So they called. I had to run home, put a suit on, come back down. And I just got in the door. I couldn't even get in. The guy was like, you're not fucking playing. Seriously. So I was like, I get in, and the team just Toronto just wanted a shootout. And then we got on a flight and went to Long Island, and that's when I got
And the guy at the door was like, you don't play for the Leafs.
100%.
But he goes,
I wouldn't make that up. He was just like, I'm like, no, I'm playing. And he's like, no, you're not.
He's like, come on.
How is that to play for the Marlies, though? Like, AHL-wise, that's got to be pretty good. I mean, like, it's a sick city. Like, you have a ton of money within their, like, AHL team. Like, it must have been at least, like, not what you were hoping for coming back, but not, like, playing in a shitty AHL city.
No, it was awesome, actually. We had a great team. Bates, I think you had Bates on here.
Bates Battaglia?
Yeah, he was my...
His bar in North Carolina got Pink Whitney.
I don't think he resonated well with our fan base, first of all, because we have a lot of Boston people, and he was chirping.
I don't think he knew what this podcast was about or anything. I think he was just like, what the hell am I doing?
Yeah, he was chirping Cassidy a little bit, which, I mean...
Yeah, he had a bad experience with him.
But the reason we had him on is because we've heard nothing but unbelievable things about this guy.
Yeah, he's the best. And that's... No, he is. He's just an awesome guy, and... that's surprising that he got. Well, I mean, I don't know.
But you're he didn't know. Like, he just came on and he was just like, "What am I doing right now?" Like, I don't think he like had ever heard of our show or anything. But it was still, I got a kick out of it.
Who was the one? Yeah. Who was the one guy that like when he saw you, you connected with? Well, I know you weren't up for a while with the Leafs. It was just the four games. But who was one guy where you were like, "Oh my god, this guy thinks I'm cool."
Cool.
I use that term very loosely.
No, okay. Yeah. Matt Stajan was.
Oh yeah,
he's the best man. Like the best. One of the best guys I've ever, played. Yeah, he was awesome. I can't remember. I mean, it wasn't like the.
It was quick.
It wasn't the best team.
Well, I just meant like, I mean, you're always going to look back and think, oh, my experience there was positive.
Joseph was awesome guy.
Cujo was there.
He was awesome.
We're gonna get him on the podcast.
I mean, everyone was pretty, I know what you mean. My roommate was Anton Strahlman, who, I mean, nice guy.
He's still buzzing out there.
Yeah. It's a great question. But Stajan, probably I still talk to him a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, so
we can come back to that one.
Stajan definitely thinks I'm cool.
I didn't mean to put you on.
If that's what you're asking.
Let's go back.
Stajan will say I'm a good guy.
I didn't mean to put you on your heels there.
Well, yeah. I mean, you did a little bit.
He's like, I don't know anyone that likes me. Yeah. So
well, then I don't like your... God, guys, hey, well, you know, actually, you've come to mind, I don't like this fucking beef jerky. Yeah. I actually hate it.
It's Bill Tongue, okay?
Did you remember who the first tackle was on yet?
Huh?
Who the first goal was on? Who you scored the first goal?
Brian Elliott.
I just saw him in the lobby.
Yeah, but I didn't score it. Jason Spezza actually shot it in for me.
And then you took it.
Well, Jason Blake threw it at the net, and I kind of like did like the poke,
Ryan Smith.
And then it went back door, and Spezza like tapped it in.
But they didn't change it.
No, Spezza wasn't on my team.
Oh.
Guys, this was like 2009.
Spezza's on the Leafs.
Oh,
yeah.
Stapleton was setting us up to fail there.
You guys really know your stats.
Big deal. Of course they played your one game against
the
Sens.
I'm like, I didn't know Spezza had one for the Leafs this year.
No.
Did you sell it, though?
I knew what happened. And I remember Jason Blake was like, did you touch that? I'm like,
well, of course he's wondering because he wants his fucking cookie. We want to talk about Jason Blake?
Yeah. Well, no, I'm not going to talk about it. I mean, what do you want to know? What do you want to talk about? You know him?
No, I mean, then.
I'll say Jason Blake got traded. I don't know if he signed or got traded to the Ducks. He might have signed with him. I don't know. But I played with him. And then I got traded from the Ducks to Edmonton. And then the last game of the year, the Oilers were in Anaheim, so all my stuff was still in Anaheim because I got traded and had to go that day. So after the game, I had already talked to Steve Tambellini and the Oilers GM and coaching staff. I was like, hey, I'm just going to like stay here and like go home. Like I'm not gonna go back to Edmonton because all my stuff's here. Like the season was over, not really many exit meetings. Things were changing. So the game ended. We lost to the Ducks. They didn't make the playoffs either. I go out to Sharky's, and Jason Blake was on the team, and he came up to me. I remember sitting at the bar, and he's like, "How fucking awful is it for you that you're in Edmonton?" Oh, and I was just like, "Dude, fuck off!" Like it was like just rubbing, like kicking a man when he's down. I was like, "I got 4 more years of my contract up there," but I didn't know him that well. I just remember that night, him just like, "Yeah, you must be so miserable." I was like, "Thanks, bro. Just go. Can I get another shot, please? I'm gonna have my own drink one day, but I don't have it yet." But
you know, because my line was him and Dominic Moore.
Oh, I know Dom Moore.
And
I think
they hated each other.
Oh, yeah. Really?
I remember Jason Blake came up to me like first face off. He's like, "Don't pass him the puck."
Now what, it's like, what a team.
Okay.
I was I'm 16.
So that's why I asked about Jason fucking Blake, all right? You fucking asshole. That's why I asked you. And now you're the one fucking spinning the roast here.
No, I'm just.
Oh, shit.
And,
well, they obviously had beef. You're
but
like,
that was my first game.
I'm going to pass it to each of you.
I'm like, I don't want the puck, eh?
Hey, listen.
I was like, I'm just trying to not turn it over.
Any don't pass to the guy on the line meetings was me leading them, and I was the guy
nobody would pass to.
Who they shouldn't have been passing to, and I was leading charge, buddy.
Viz couldn't even get a pass in like warm up 3-on-2s.
3-on-2s.
Don't give it to him.
The 2-on-1s. Just the guy would just basically do a big loop of the ice and go, because the goalies didn't want to get hit in the face. I couldn't control that thing. Come on.
Well, I'm like fast forwarding right through the career. The next year, you signed with a two-way with the Atlanta Thrashers. It looks like it was a two-year two-way because you were up and down both years with Atlanta. Spent most of the
One year.
And then you re-signed with them again? And
then I signed 2 years.
Okay.
I went to San Antonio.
Oh, fuck. I played in San Antonio.
I mean, if you want to know all my stats, I'll tell you.
Hey, I'm looking at them. I'm looking at them. AHL was a joke. I mean, like, AHL, you were probably like, this is too easy. You were kind of the guy. There's a bunch of people that was, like, too good for the AHL, but people said you couldn't play in the NHL.
Perfect for Europe.
Right?
Yeah, pretty much. Well, it was
like, AHL was too easy, yet.
Well, I don't know if it was too. I mean,
I don't know. I mean, you're getting over a point per game. It certainly was like, you got to be in your mind, like, I can play in the NHL. I'm dominating here, but you're never going up and getting, like, first or second line minutes, right?
Exactly. No, that's, I mean, you guys know how it works. I mean,
yeah.
But it was, you know how the AHL is. It's just a bunch of guys who, in their mind, should be in the NHL. So it's
he's getting called up.
Yeah.
He sucks.
Yeah. It's like the guy. I felt like a lot in the AHL. You're sitting next to a guy who's like, you're sitting next to you all year, and he's like, yeah, like talking to you, but he's hoping you like blow your knee out so he can get on the power. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, okay.
He's like, hey man, nice pass.
Yeah. He's like, spritz.
Wow, three assists.
He's like,
states,
oh yeah,
huh?
We're going out tonight. Sure, yeah, spritz in your drink.
Yeah.
Was it cool at least playing in your hometown? I mean,
the Wolves was awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was real. Yeah, that was one of my favorites.
Did you win a Calder Cup?
No, I didn't win shit.
He's never won anything.
I was surrounded by losers my whole career. Okay, so
like legit shit.
Like I didn't win. I haven't won shit like ever. Ever. Like, it's like,
he doesn't even have a veteran who thought he was cool.
Hey, we
gotta
enter, like, the anti-Chris Drury.
We're gonna enter you in a beef jerky contest.
Hey, Boyke's built.
He just got second place in a South African beef jerky contest. Still can't get a win.
Dude, you should see me in these.
But it was in North America.
Yeah,
and it was the only participant.
They're like, we're just gonna give you second because there's got to be somebody better. No, it's actually awesome. Check it out, Boygies. All right. Well then,
edit that.
Then you get a chance. You got one full year in the NHL in Winnipeg. You had a great year. So what happened in signing there and playing, you know, 63, 65 games, whatever it was.
And the lockout. Why'd you get
That was after that.
They offered me to go back. Yeah.
Oh no shit.
And then I just went to Russia because we all knew there was going to be a lockout.
Well, here they go. Let's start the campfire.
Yeah. I just want like the
I
Russia
hope there's
thing,
another one.
The Russia thing for you. You did you know anyone over there?
Nigel Dawes.
Oh.
So you were able to talk to one person. Like, what is it?
Well,
like?
Him and I think Soaps was before me. So I tried to talk. Well, yeah, I think I talked to Soaps. It was. I remember I talked to Dawsey. And
the
he
king
was,
over there.
Oh, he's a man, yeah. And he tells me, like, the worst.
Now, who's that, Dawes? Is that Kevin Dahlman?
Nigel Dahlman.
Yeah.
Kevin Dahlman's from my area.
Still lighting up. I'm like, is this?
Oh, no, he's making.
Oh, just killing it.
Bank.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so, no, he told me all his stuff, and he's like, and then at the end of the conversation, he's like, everything I told you, just remember this. It's way worse. Hey, and it was
and that's
unbelievable.
What this guy told me. He goes, everything I'm telling you, I promise, it's not, you'll go over there and it won't be this bad. It's probably worse than I'm telling you.
Yeah.
Just petrifying to hear, but like you said, you wanted that money. What'd you sign for the first year over there in Minsk?
Money talk on this podcast is cool. Nobody thinks you're rubbing it in.
Oh yeah,
oh, like, yeah.
Do you not even? He probably doesn't even remember this.
Yeah,
fucking
it was like
mess.
$1 million.
Oh, $1 million bucks.
Yeah. That's fucking.
Yeah, I
nice.
Mean, like,
900.
Dude. So going around, and once you were in Russia, like, was Belarus different, or was it all the same?
Yeah, it was
Minsk,
a little
city,
bit different. Yeah, it's not bad. It's you know, they're still they call them Belarusians, but yeah. I mean, they spoke like a different, like a slang Russian, but I mean, it was all the same.
And a lot of people come on the podcast and they say like, oh yeah, it was bad. Do you have like in-depth stories you'd like to share? Because I feel
I
like our
couple,
fan,
I got a couple.
Our fan base seems to like, oh, how crazy is it? How really wacky is it? And
well, the everyday stuff, as Whit knows, that's how I view. I mean, whatever doesn't make sense there.
Okay, so right? what was the craziest experience you saw where you're like, what? The fuck is happening?
What the fuck is like what you say like once a, like every 2 days? You just, like you say
hour,
it by
once
yourself.
An hour.
You once say an hour. You, yeah, you're just like alone. Like what the
trying
fuck?
To shower, blood comes
yeah.
out. Like.
Just like, well, me and Henny lived together. Our water was permanently brown the whole year. Well, we had to buy like every, like big water, you know, if we wanted to cook and boil.
You cook with bottled
yeah,
water.
Yeah, yeah.
This guy played with my good friend Josh Hennessy, who's going to come on here at some point, in Neftahemik. And when I saw you the first time there, it was like a wounded dog. And Hennessy has a couple stories that he reminded me of. One is like, do you remember just your meltdown when they ended up getting rid of Hennessy? Because he wrote to me what you did. And it doesn't surprise you one bit when you just completely snapped on everyone when Hennessy got let go.
What? Oh, man, yeah. Well, that's...
this is the text.
Make sure
you ask him about his meltdown when he got into the rink the day I got fired in Neftahemik. He started screaming down the hall for a trade, told the video coach, the only guy who spoke English, to go to the head coach and tell that fat fuck I'm not playing one more shift in this place. I don't know if he remembers it as clearly as I do, but I just remember laughing because I was the fired one.
Yeah, well, we ended up having like 5 coaching changes that year. And really? We ended up getting a Russian guy. Yeah, before like November.
Is that a record in the KHL?
No, it's
5
very,
head coaches.
It was, like, that's not even a record in the KHL.
But you should see. Eventually, it was just like, you know, is that the fucking physio guy? That's, like, you didn't even know who the head coach was anymore. And half the games we play because we lost.
The head coach is giving me ice after the game.
This guy's the Bill Burr of hockey.
The half the games we lost like 10 in a row, and they came in. They're like, and it was, we were supposed to get paid, and they're like, we're just not paying you.
No.
Yeah, until you win. And we didn't.
You guys were shit. Like, we beat you guys.
Yeah, yeah, we were.
You guys
pretty
were
bi-
trash.
I mean, I just said we
it
lost
was you, Hennessy, and Sexton. Sexton was nasty there.
He's really good.
Is he still over there?
Yeah, he's with
so you
Dodgers.
Guys lose 10 in a row. They're not paying you.
Not paying us, and then we ended up winning one game, but they brought this Igor Krikanov, this fucking guy. Holy fuck, this guy.
Oh, Igor Krikanov is the
Krikanov.
Perfect name.
Yeah, Igor
for the bad
Krikanov.
Guy.
I'm not making this. And this guy was like old Soviet.
We're making
like,
a t-shirt.
Like, yeah. We
already have a t-shirt
Creek
on the website.
You're like, what up, Creek?
He's like, what the nickname? And I'm like, Creek. And I'm like, fuck, who's this guy? Dude, the second day, he had us running. I don't know, did Henny tell you about? Oh, you got to get Henny on here. But he had us running.
His memory's unreal.
Oh, God. His surgery stories.
Yeah,
one
yeah,
of the
yeah,
best
yeah.
stories.
What was the running story?
Wait, go back to the fucking whatever Krikanov guy.
Russia does you, and you just become fucking crazy.
Creek
you can't,
dog,
like stay on point.
You start South African.
Yeah, you're like this is not my fault, guys. This is fucking KHL. 4 years.
4 years.
Super late.
I heard that episode. It's amazing. That's so true because you would be like, if you missed a breakaway, as you know, like a guy like would come down the bench that pass, and you'd be like, Tim. Why no score?
Yeah, you're like,
you're like, fuck, I'm going to look this guy up after the game. And he had like one goal in fucking 25 years. Like, this is the guy that's fucking yelling at me? Seriously, and you couldn't, it was just like, holy
fuck. Yeah, you don't even know. You're like, who is this guy?
The guy that doesn't use any shampoo or soap in the shower? And the guy that's had one goal in 25 years is telling me.
Why you have no score?
Yeah, Tim, you no score. And I'm like, dude, I don't, like, I didn't score because I didn't want to see you celebrate your fucking assist. You don't even know who scores in that league. Yeah, when know, you see a replay. There's four different celebrations. The one guy's windmilling who shot the puck.
Second assist.
Yeah. It's like, who the fuck scored here? Yeah, it's fucking amazing.
It's true.
It's amazing.
No, you score and you turn looking for guys and there's just celebrations everywhere.
No idea. No idea. So anyways, back to this run.
Creek.
Yeah. Creek, this is no joke. He would have us running 10 kilometers in like this, a snowstorm in the middle of the night. And we would get, we just, no, I mean, Henny would run together. Like, what the
fuck? Yeah, like, and you're like, I'm not doing
And we
doing
would
this.
Run halfway, and all of a sudden we'd come across this, like, this fucking Jeep with its lights on, and this fucking fucking Creek has got his head out the window.
This is middle of the night.
He's just sitting in the thing with his head out the window. You had to run up to him, make eye contact, and run back.
You had to run up to him, smell his Russian breath, and then turn around and run back.
And he was just, like, he spoke no English, obviously. And then Dawsey had him for, like, 5 years, I think.
Yeah, but Dawsey got 40 every year, probably.
Well, that's the thing, is when I got traded to Keenan's team, which was, like, one psycho to another.
Dude, that was the year I was
We talk about him all the time. He's a nut job. Was he? Oh, so he probably went to the KHL because he could be that nutty in today's climate.
That was some of the best times for me.
Let's go. Open it up.
That was the year I was with you. I was in the league that year.
Yeah, he was. That's right. We met like in warm-ups. That's how it was over there. Like if you saw another North American, you just saw each other and were like, man, keep going.
No, dude, no. You can't. No, you must not remember. You got Russianized. You can't. You came over in the morning and he looked into my locker room and he's like, Wait, and I was just like, was that Stapleton? Like, I didn't know him. He's like, come here. And we went out and we just like hugged, not even knowing each other. He's like, how you doing, man? I'm like, good, how you doing? He's like, not good, man, not good. And we just shot the shit for 20 minutes. I was like, he's now my brother for life.
And you're like, I gotta go take my shit. He's like, don't leave me.
No, I was like, hold on. Let me get my phone. I cut his number. It's +47777375764735464, +64. And I just texted Wit. And then we would text like every night. And he's like, I got you traded to Magnitogorsk. I'm like, oh, dude, you're going to be here till like April 28th. You guys were nasty.
That's when the ruble crashed.
It was when the ruble crashed. Oh, and you were making bank over there.
And Witt was buying Louis Vuitton over there because it was cheaper.
Yeah, but I had millions back home to begin with.
No, but you were buying it because it was like it was smarter to buy that and then maybe resell it over here.
Oh, when it crashed?
Yeah, when the ruble crashed.
You were trying to take advantage
of that? No, I was buying. I didn't resell it, but yeah, I remember being like, I'm just going to buy all this shit now. Nice couple nice Louis travel bags.
I bought some Louis shit. You had to.
Yeah, you had to. Well, they all had Louis sweat pants and
They wore the same fart suit. That's what we call them. It was like a full sweatsuit, and they wore it the fucking whole 10-day trip. Like they would wear.
Oh
that
yeah, and they weren't getting it dry cleaned at the Ritz. Like I just got my pants for
and
tomorrow.
And then if you came in with like a something Louis Vuitton or something, they would like fucking examine it. Yeah, is that real? They like knew if it was. I was like, dude, this
They're
is
like,
fucking
oh, wait,
real.
Big money.
This is real. Okay, calm down. You fucking Jesus.
All right, Mike, hey, we got
any Abercrombie shirts?
Me?
No, the other Russians. Like Abercrombie.
Why? Is that a big thing?
Aeropostale. Like they would wear like shitty American.
I played on some, you know, like the wealthy Russian players, like the really good players. So these guys would, like the captain of.
What was Mozyakin making?
The captain of Magnitogorsk, Zharapov, he had like fucking 7 cars and. He would always tell me about him. And finally one day I caught him like coming to the rink and he comes out of the back seat of the car. So he has a permanent driver, and I'm like sitting there. I'm like, "How the fuck, how can you say this is a nice car? You don't even drive it." But that's the kind of guy. The guys I was playing with is the guys that spent all this fucking money. So as far as Abercrombie, Fitch, and all that, no, it was always Louis Vuitton, Dolce & Gabbana, and shit. But yeah,
so
I don't know.
These guys, man.
Yeah,
they're out of control.
Yeah, it was different.
What's the most ridiculous amount of money you saw a Russian teammate spend? Like what? Like were you at a super club with him by accident?
The one guy threw his. We went to like a his son's 3-year-old. It was his 3-year-old birthday party, and he spent $40,000. They had like fucking, you know, like these lava funnel, like ice cream cakes. They had like fucking Alaskan dogs. It's like a like Circus Olation for a 3-year-old.
Hey,
I'm like, what are you going to do when this kid turns 16?
Kid don't even remember.
It's like, there's a private jet, son.
Hey, Mal.
yeah. Like, don't drink and fly.
So, it was like Malkin's kid's birthday recently. He hired a bunch of people to dress up as his whole team. Like, there was a Crosby out there in a full Penguins uniform. There was a Malkin guy. There was a Gonchar. And these guys just go over the top for the birthdays. It's like Sweet 16 on acid.
Man, it was insane.
He might have even hired Sidney Crosby to come over for the fucking birthday party.
New Year's Eve was a gong show in that country. They went unbelievable. Hard on New Year's Eve. That's like their number one.
And then Putin always comes and talks. Did you probably don't remember that.
Well,
and everyone stops what they're doing and watches.
Yeah, and they listen to him.
Yeah, I know. They love him.
They're like, Vladimir, tell us more.
Let's go back to the other dictator first. Mike Keenan, was he just all about head games?
He liked you, right?
No. Oh, I don't know. Maybe he did. I mean,
shit on you, though?
Oh, fuck. It was brutal. but here's the thing. Growing up, he coached here. Right, the early 90s.
Yeah,
so I kind of like Iron Mike. Like, it was kind of cool for me to get traded to him at first.
Until you caught that.
Well, he called me when I got traded, and he was like, my son was being born like in a month, and he was like the nicest guy ever. And I was, you know, I kind of hung up and was just like, man, this guy's a pretty good guy. And I knew all about, you know, his whole story, and it's all psychological. And then I get there, and we had a day off, and then I go meet him in person. Great guy. And you know, I believe in, because they won it that year, the year before I came.
Yeah, they were sick.
So he was like, I believe that, you know, and trying to win back-to-back, you got to change, you know, about 15% of your team or 10%, like all this whole theory. And he's like, that's why we're bringing you in. And I thought it was great. I was going to come in for like secondary scoring. So where I'm going with this is the next day after that was our first practice. And I'm, you know, I don't really know anyone. I'm putting my skates on. He comes bombing in and he's like, where the fuck Stapleton? He's got this high voice and his back's to me. Stapleton, where the fuck are you? This is in front of the whole team.
And you just the day before had a nice little...
I had the phone call and I met him in person. And then he just... I'm like, hey, you know, I'm right here. And he turns around and he's just like, what position are you? You a forward, defenseman, center? I've never heard of you. You know what it was? That was just what
just
he did.
Total just total
ass. Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, that was his...
You were probably like...
Now
forward? I can't... You last night
time
we
out.
Talked.
Now, do you think that was... planned and he knew he was doing that, or he's just that fucking senile?
I have no idea, because like you said, it was different. You know, there was me and him and one other North American, I think. So I don't know. I still wonder that. You know, and but it was pretty, you know, he was trying to be, I think, the old Iron Mike, but people don't know the, you know, other players that have played for him probably ask the same question themselves, like, is it personal or is it part of like what
the whole
it took me about 6 weeks before
I would have personally, if I would have had to have dealt with that, and fuck, we talk about him so much in this podcast, and I'm trying to figure out like what's the fucking angle, because I truly believe I truly believe that someone isn't that fucking evil inside, where I would have went up to him and called him in the office and I would have said, hey, do you genuinely not know what position I play, or are you just trying to fuck with me?
Yeah.
Him in the eyes and genuinely ask him and then hear his answer. And if he's still playing mind games, that's when you say, like, dude, fuck you.
But like, here's the thing, though, is he, like, I, you know, like, knew all about this going into this, right? And it definitely was mine. I don't think it was, it definitely wasn't personal. It was just his strategy. It fucking worked. Like, yeah. I was mentally...
You were like...
Dude, he fucked
with
me.
Well, wait. It worked in what sense?
I was playing, like everyone says, like Jeremy Roenick always says, like, my best years were with him. Like,
Playing scared.
Yeah. And I was, okay. Here I was, 32 years
now,
old.
Now, the opposite for some guys in which, A, maybe he doesn't want those guys on board, whereas there's some people in your situation, which played your best, they fold.
Why did I don't even know if I played. I had 14 goals going up to that, and then I had 4 with him.
Okay,
and
so you didn't play better.
But no, but I played.
You didn't play as much, right?
I didn't play as much because I was because they had Mosey. They had the studs, and I got
that.
They
were sick.
But for me, it was more of like I played really like as hard as I could. Right? There was no.
Did he back off considering that?
Until I told him to go fuck himself.
Yeah, it took six weeks, right? Okay, so I want to ask you. It took six weeks for what?
It got so bad. I was like calling people that played for him, like Rene Bork played for him, and I'm like, what do I do? I'm like trying to watch documentaries on this shit, and he was just he was good at what he did on that.
It's different though when he was in Calgary and he's torturing people. It's different when you are two of some of the only English
speaking
guys.
That's what I'm saying,
guys.
Man. That's evil.
More like, buddy, that's fucking, why I'm over here like alone.
That's what I'm
like,
saying.
It's not like we're all in the NHL.
You can see me in my face.
Like, why are you fucking giving it to me this bad?
I'm dying inside here.
Yeah, and that's so true. And then,
eventually you called him out, so.
What'd you say to him?
Tell the story.
Let's say that.
No, because he was just kind of, you know, doing that a lot to me. And I just... I don't know. We were on the bench in one game, and we were playing at Kazan, and that was the team I was
and
on.
You used to be, yeah,
yeah, and I got fired. And I led, I led the team in goals too. I got fired.
That, I need to ask about that, but go ahead. I'll go back.
And we were getting smoked by them. So when he calls his lines, you know, if us three were a line, like he, you know, Whitney, if you were center, Biz, and then you know Stapleton. So he, that's what he does every time he calls a line.
Says all three.
All three. So you know, it was a. Beginning of the second period, and he was just going, Biz, Whitney, and then I could see him like look at me, and he'd be like, shake his head, and then he'd just go like, Igor, take the right side. So he did this for like a full period.
And he's looking at you, he's like, I'm not playing.
Yeah, yeah, and he did it for like a full period, and then finally he put me out there with like, you know, a minute left, and the puck just kind of shot out. I had like a 7 second shift, and then he came down to me. As I came off, because he saw me, I was finally like, fuck this. And I just never been a guy that's been what you're saying.
Enough's enough, though.
Yeah, I just never really had that problem with coaches, but enough was enough. And he came down and started saying something. He's like, you know why this team traded you? Because you're a fucking pussy, like da da da. And finally, I was just like, you know, this team didn't trade me. They fired me. Like,
it wasn't that was even your like, comeback?
Yeah, that was my comeback.
What a shitty comeback.
Yeah, I go,
he's like, exactly.
I can tell you're not used to conflict.
I know I'm a pussy and I suck, but I didn't get traded. You know, honestly, I was like.
You just had nothing to say.
Like, here's the thing. Like, I was trying to say, like, you fucking idiot, but it can't, you know, and then he came, like, face to face. He literally goes, what'd you say? And I go, I'm just like, I can't say anything. I'm just, like, fucking so mad. And he goes, tell me to go fuck myself. Swear to God. And I go, what? He goes, tell me to go fuck myself.
He's on the bench.
Just on the bench. He's like this far away. And he's like, tell me to go fuck myself. That's how crazy this guy was. And I'm like, no. He goes, tell me. I'm like, fuck you. And I just like, I lost it. And I'm just saying all this shit.
That's what I'm saying. This is fucked
yeah,
up.
That's so then, tab.
This
that's
is exactly tab. What we needed so then, for people to know how crazy this guy is on our podcast.
And then every shift in the third, I went every other shift. Any two guys he called Stapleton, take the right side.
He was
I
waiting
like
for you.
I played like 15 minutes in the third period. And then,
that's when you got like, on the Russian gas.
Yeah. Oh, so Russian gas. That's another thing. I'm a Russian gas eating. Junkie.
Oh, how good was that shit?
I've done this thing
how
like 20. I've done it like 25 times.
I'm trying to get it on Amazon Prime sent to my house now. Russian gas. Get me going every day.
Yeah. Oh, dude.
How good was that shit?
If there was
the needle before the game?
If there was a Russian gas rehab... I would be fucking leading meetings and that thing.
No, they're but, like, you. But, before the second period, they're like, Russia gas. They're like, Stapleton, no more, no yeah, more. We yeah. One-time game, one-time
oh,
game.
Oh, I used to try to, but I was, you know that shit's really expensive. It's like $300.
Really?
Usage. Yeah. And these guys mosaicking them. So I was on teams that, we had a Russian gas like guy that traveled with us.
He was all gas.
Oh, all gas. And one time I walked in on him because we had like an optional practice and then the trainer was like, hey, team, gas? And I was like, absolutely. It's 11 in the morning. Like,
I'd gas me up.
My hey, brain little, is hey, still recovering.
Little mimosa.
From
yeah, little pillow yeah, OJ yeah. in there.
But gas. You're like, instead of having a sip on a mimosa, you have a guy like fucking suffocating you with, you know, how weird was it?
It was insane.
Because you're on your back and this Russian guy is just like, fuck, it's like...
Oh, no, so I never got the mask. I got the
oh, what
needle.
What kind of gas were you doing?
I got... We call,
you didn't even do the gas.
I didn't do the... My gas was the needle, though. It's still the Russian gas, bro. You're fueling your body with Russian gas via a needle. But I didn't get the actual, like,
oh, you
gas
were doing,
mask.
You were doing
yeah,
the gas
yeah,
mask.
3 minutes of, like, and you're just breathing. And I was, like, I was, you know, listening to techno music. And
you're like, crystal
fucking,
meth's unreal.
You know, and then you get up and you're... speaking like fluent Russian for fucking 10 seconds and then you come to and you drive home. But dude,
спасибо, спасибо.
Yeah, yeah, I'm just like,
hey, what team was it with the dude fucking the team trainer put
well,
he gassed
I was just
himself.
Gonna say that's what I was saying. I wasn't on the team, the guy that died, I think.
Yeah, yeah,
not the
yeah, no, not like
making fun of death.
No, but I walked in
he
on
fell
our
asleep?
Guy. I walked in on our gas guy laying sideways because I think he thought we had practice and he was gassing himself. Swear to God. And I was like, I swear to God. He's like sideways. He's like gassed himself. So I kind of knocked and he's like, oh, he fucking, niet, Tim, niet. And I'm like,
gas session.
I'm like, I would be doing up. That all day, buddy. keep going. I mean, finish the session.
Blow it in my mouth. Yeah, blow it in my mouth.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was...
Secondhand gas.
Yeah, yeah, give it to me.
I don't even know what it really did. I just know it was like an unbelievable 3 minutes.
So, wait. So, okay, so you would do it pre-game?
No. It was always like either long travel. Like, he said it was for like, if you're traveling a lot or games.
And you would notice a difference? Like what you just felt like you were at your best?
He's like, yeah, no, you ever smoked a monster bowl?
Yeah,
it's like that.
I like getting high. Nothing to do with my performance. This had to do with the 3 minutes of forgetting that I was in Russia.
Have you ever hit a Juul 53 times in a row?
Becoming a Russian.
Becoming a Russian, yeah. No, it was...
It's like making a murderer, making a Russian.
You know what? I'm like fucking... Henny was always like nervous of like, you can't like bash... the KHL was great.
Well, listen.
KHL was fucking awesome.
It was awesome. We got great stories from it.
I got a beautiful house today.
We got great stories.
It was great.
But Kazan, you brought it up. That's a big-time team over there. It's like Ska, Seska, Magnitogorsk, Kazan. Like, what's the other really good one? Automobiles. What city is that?
Automobiles.
What team is that? Metalburg, whatever. It doesn't matter.
Who knows?
Kazan, it's a big deal. You go over there and you're playing well. Like, how did that firing go down? You just get a call one day? You're done.
Yeah, that was exactly what happened.
And you never even found out what they didn't like about you?
No, I had a bad playoffs. And it was like the first time they lost in like the first round. Like I said, I'm a fucking...
You're a loser.
Yeah, I'm a
mush. You never won a thing.
I'm a mush. You guys want to go to the casino after and lose?
Dude, I can't win anything.
No, but he... and that was the thing. I had a good, decent regular season and then... Playoffs, I was awful, and then they weren't really happy, and then I think they heard like I was trying to like trade myself,
which you were probably.
I might have been. Yeah, I was, fuckers. And then I just got a call and they're like, you're fired. And I was like, all right. And they paid me. The next day.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. So I was like, and then I signed a Neftahemic.
That was,
dude. The Neftahemic selling point. This coach called me, and I knew about the town. I'm like, dude. You know,
about the what?
The town. The town was just fucking a dump. And swear to God, this guy was like, dude, we got a Burger King. Like, that was it. I was like, wait, say that again? You got a Burger King? And then he was like, yeah, man. You know, and I'm like, really? Is that the... I'm in. I was going to be like, I'm in. I love Burger King. But that was like his selling point. That's how bad this town is.
You're like, the new fries or the old fries?
Yeah. I'm like, the breaded chicken?
Like O'Shea's in Vegas.
Every time you show up, we're going to give you a cardboard crown.
Yeah, yeah. And it was,
you are going to get a cardboard crown.
He was a Finnish guy, and he was trying so hard to like sell me where he was. And I knew where he was. I'm like, dude, you can't. He's like, man, it's not that bad. Like, you could tell in his voice, too. He's like losing his breath.
You tell there's a gun to his head
like,
while he was saying
it. 3 days, man. It's pretty good. We got a Burger King. And I'm like, what?
Okay, well, what about the other thing Hennessy had?
He's getting waterboarded while telling you. Hey. Tell him there's a fucking Burger King.
Yeah, he's got the guys in the back
tell
of the
car. Tell him you're a Blockbuster, too.
Yeah, yeah.
He's got the two red dots on
internet.
His chest.
We have internet. Tell him.
All right, so how about this one in Neftahemic? You know, every KHL point matters, right? You know, these games are... You get win bonuses over there. You win a game, you fucking make a little money. So, Neftahemic goes to a shootout. This guy being one of the most skilled players on all the teams he played on. The coach says, go ahead in the shootout. Nope. This guy goes, nope. Turns around, goes, I ain't shooting. So, the first two guys go, and coach goes, please, Tim, shoot. Please. And you ended up, Hennessy said, you ended up going, fuck, fine. You went down and buried it low blocker for the game winner. But why the hell were you saying no originally?
That's a true story. I don't know. I mean, it was my third year in Russia. I didn't know what the fuck, too much Russian gas. Like, dude, I don't know. Like, that's just how I...
You were just like, no.
Yeah. Like,
no. And doesn't know why. Imagine being no, I'm not going.
The Krikanov story, the reason I got traded on that is because I was, by the 10th game with him, the same thing happened. Third period came, and every time my line came, I was like, Max, go. And so, after fucking eight shifts, they fucking were like, they realized I was just at the end of the bench.
You were basically.
I benched myself. I was like, I'm not playing anymore. And then I got on the plane, and my agent called me. He's like, Igor Krikanov has seen some crazy shit, but he's never seen someone bench themselves. And I was like, dude, I'm like, I don't know. Like,
this Stapleton's too crazy for me. We need to cut him.
Yeah.
He's crazy.
Yeah.
He's overdosing on our gas.
You know what? I was actually kind of hurt. I was hurt. And I was like, they, I'm not going they didn't out believe there. Me. They didn't believe me.
So yeah, that's like.
Did you guys hear the story though? How this we went on? They said we went on strike. You were no.
Oh yeah,
that made like the Washington
Post.
Yeah,
what the hell is that?
That's this whole story.
Okay, let's hear.
Well, it's just basically kind of.
I forgot about
it.
It
kind of just goes after that because I was just the next game.
Wasn't your groin?
Yeah, I was. Yes. I was. That's the thing. It wasn't like I was like
you couldn't.
I was just like, dude, I'm fucking brutal out here. Like I don't even want to. You know what I mean? And I was just like, I don't. Like I just can't play, and this guy would like didn't believe me, and so the next game I finally called. You know, I told my agent, I'm like, listen, I had to bench myself. Like fucking, they don't, you know, just and so they let me sit out that game, and then Sexton had a concussion from that you know he sat out that game, and then our import goalie was like running around the rink from Finnish guy, he like sprained his ankle, so we had three guys, and this was like literally when the ruble crashed. So they thought we ruble crashed, the imports aren't playing. And it came out that we were on strike.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that's who it was.
And then the
phantom.
Next game, my agent called me in the morning. He's like, hey, like everyone thinks you went on strike. You have to play tonight. And we were in fucking.
Dude, my groin
dude,
still pulled.
Listen to this. We were in Novo Kuznets. You ever been?
Yeah, we talked about it.
Oh, we talked about it.
It was
Sopel. It's like
Sopel
the
oh, yeah.
drug Crocodile capital of the planet.
You know, so, I mean, you see soaps now. I'm kidding. I love soaps.
I know. I know. We guys are buddies.
I hope he laughs at that. but, and they made me do an MRI and at this fucking. I can't even. They put me on a.
And like a,
you
a
ever seen the movie Kickboxer with Van Damme?
No,
right
he might.
Yeah,
have.
Yeah, oh, yeah. I've
that's,
seen Kickboxer.
When the brother gets his back broken, and the fucking, you know, they just carry him out on this piece of wood and throw yeah, him in the fucking parking lot.
His MRI comes like, back. It's a color by number.
No, listen.
It's
they put
on
me
a fucking Viewmaster.
They put me on this.
It's a bright light.
This like wooden board, and they fucking threw me in this thing, and it was just like, they had this squeeze thing. They're like, if any discomfort, you squeeze this. And I'm squeezing this thing like within 10 seconds,
and nobody's coming in.
No, and they. What I was going is like we didn't do it like it lasted like 4 minutes because I was like I can't fucking do this, you know, so they fucking we get to the rink and I just get there in time for practice and they give Krikanov like this thing like he's gonna read an MRI.
They gave so the coach
yeah,
an MRI.
Yeah, so they fucking read. I know in my head.
Coach is like this.
No, and I
no pull, no tear.
No, and I know in my head this thing was a 4 minute, you know. So I'm just like whatever. He's like doing the thing. He's like
the coach.
He not injured. You know, I'm like, wait a minute. Like, you know, so then I played.
I go medical school,
so
too.
Yeah, fucking play.
I played. Down, BJ, this, dude, this story gets even crazier. So I played, man. And then I ended up scoring the game-winning goal. So then we came back, and we finished that road trip and went home.
You remember who it was against? Oh, no, because that's, sorry.
Yeah, some Igor. You mean the goalie's name?
Oh, Igor.
I don't know, yeah. If Kenny.
No, I forgot the team.
We have a 50%
chance. Good
And Muhammad.
Alexander.
We covered all bases.
The next day, we had a day off, but we never had days off. It was like you had to come to the rink and take a sauna or play soccer or something. So
you were like gas.
Yeah. So we came to the rink, and the coach gave this fucking speech, and he's like, I'm hearing my name like every five Stapleton. And I'm sitting there kind of like,
that's never good.
But I'm kind of, I took it as like, okay. Like,
he's pumping my.
Yeah.
Why can't you be more like Stapleton?
Yeah, battle through injury. Yeah, score
like,
a couple.
I scored, you know what I mean? I was injured, MRI, and I scored and all this shit. So in my head, I'm like, okay, you know, like I'll take that. Yeah. So he said meeting. All that shit. And then the team, you know, after the meeting ended, the team went and worked out. And they took me downstairs, and they did these, like, bike sprints. Like, I'm in this dungeon doing these bike sprints. But in my mind was, like, I'm just doing a separate workout, right? So I'm down there.
Holy
this fucking,
fuck, dude.
Yeah, and the assistant coach is, like, just screaming at me. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'll work hard, you know. Like, I'm just, you know.
Such a fake work.
And then I got done, and I'm just down there. And then, like, another player showed up, and I'm just by myself. And he's sitting there, and he's biking, you know, by himself. And I'm like, what are you doing? And he's like, oh, I'm sick, you know, faking a cough or whatever they do. And he looks at me and he's like, how do you feel? He was a Russian guy. And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, about what Krikanov said. And I'm like, I feel
that
great.
Was in Russian, bro.
I mean, I'm dude, a leader.
He's pumping my tires.
He's like, he's a doctor too. You didn't know?
Yeah, I figured I'm going to be getting the captaincy here. So, you know, and he... No, and he's like, well, he said that you fake injury, you're fined $1,000, and you're no longer part of the team. And then and that's what they were punishing me. And
what
yeah.
The fuck.
Yeah, and
you
then
scored the game four game winner.
Yeah, and then I that's the,
talk
I,
about
and
fake
that's
news.
And then I went nuts, you know. But yeah, I called my agent and said, "Get me the fuck out of here."
Holy this shit. Creaking yeah. off guy still coaching? That,
I have no idea.
Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to say this on behalf of you is creaking off, because I would imagine this is going to somehow get to him because we have Russian reporters that do listen to our podcast. Is this is the type of shit we're talking about when we bash on Russia? So what your boy creaking off did to Stapleton is fucking bullshit, and then he lied about him and then challenged his character. So on behalf of the Spittin Chiclets podcast, Mr. Creaking off can lick my fucking ballsack.
He ran his practices with a stopwatch, and he would, like, his theory was like, so we would do like a 2-on-1 drill for like 25. This guy wouldn't like run the practice. He would just say go
do this drill until
and then
I
he would just be
whistle.
Like talking to people, like texting on the phone, and we would like do a 2-on-1 for like 30 minutes. Like the guy was this real old school.
Oh, old school
Soviet
he was a moron
Union.
Is what
yeah.
he was.
I remember
he was a moron. Mr. Krikunov was a moron. He knows nothing about the game. He's a fucking drill
Dude,
sergeant.
He had a pretty good. He's had pretty good teams. I mean, like pretty good record. I think.
Yo, you brought up something so funny, and I remember there was a meeting where my Russian coach was like, "Bleh, Whitney, bleh, Whitney," and he said it like four times. Same thing. You're like, I think this is good. I'm playing okay. I don't know. And then I remember he walked out of the room, and all the Russian guys were like, "Bah!" I was like, "What? What?" And then I remember one kid was walking by. He goes, "No, not good, not good." And then one kid told me, he's like, "He said you're soft, you play like shit." I was like, "Fuck."
Yeah.
I was like, I thought that one was going good.
But even like the players would do that too sometimes. You just get like a five guys in the corner, like Stapleton, and they're they did tell me like,
yeah, like
the fuck is going on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're sitting alone in the cafeteria.
But
do you have Baza?
Oh, that Kazan was. I was going to say that about. Yeah, we in Kazan.
Baza, explain it. Win again. We've explained it a couple
times.
Go
just
ahead.
Just night before games, you got to go, and they consider it like you're with the team, and you're basically in like a
NFL style
barracks, like dorms, kind of right.
Army setting.
The one in Neftahimik was straight up like
barracks.
Yeah.
Oh.
But the one in Kazan was actually like the nice. Kazan. Yeah, but it was. The weird thing is the whole team lived in this like gated. Like a security thing, and they had a where our apartments were, and they had Baza still in this thing where we had to check in the night before a game and stay, and it was literally like 10 yards away. Like they didn't want you sleeping with like your family or anything. And they had security everywhere, and I remember one time I came home at like 3 a.m. with like a bag of McDonald's all fucked up. And the next day,
I thought it was very good.
It was on camera.
Yeah. Well, this is a different city. And then the next day, they called me in and they're like, "You can't be coming in with McDonald's at 3 a.m. And I'm like, "I didn't." And they showed me the video.
No.
They had to get up. Like, holy fuck, this place is fucked.
Fucking wife of sound.
McDonald's.
Yeah. Holy shit.
That's how I looked at it. Like, yeah. I wasn't fucked. I couldn't even get McDonald's.
Jay-Z's, hey, JB Spizo pops out of the corner. Eat all that fucking McDonald's. Eat it now and then do a 10-mile run.
Oh, my God. Well, so when Russia ended, Switzerland?
Because when I went back, we
were together. I know you went back, you sicko. But yeah. When we were together, I remember a dinner with you in Sochi, and we were like, "Dude, we gotta get to Switzerland. Switzerland's like Andy Dufresne leaving Shawshank when you're in Russia."
Yes.
You're just
great
like
analogy.
Switzerland. You're like 40 games, rich, beautiful country. Like, and then you ended up getting to pull that one off. Where'd you end up going in Swiss?
I went to Biel.
Which is good spot?
All of Switzerland. Switzerland's awesome. Well, my son was born, you know, and that's why I didn't. That's why I went to Switzerland. Like, it wasn't. I think I still would have played.
Good dough in Swiss.
No, I was terrible. That was actually terrible. Like, I was in Biel. Like, and then I got traded to Lugano.
Well, that's where Hennessy was too for a little bit.
Yeah,
Lugano.
But the Swiss league was. I mean, every league was different. Every league was like, what the fuck.
Yeah.
Kind of, you know, especially when it came to hockey. Like, no one thought the game. I mean, everyone just made it so hard. Like, in, you know, the Switzerland team I was on, the guy played man on man
on Olympic sheets.
Yeah,
you're like, dude.
So you would be like in the D zone, just like, I got my guy. So a guy, like, if a guy fell down,
breakaway.
He had a breakaway from like the hash. You know what I mean? And then like everyone's like, I got my guy.
Yeah, I had my guy.
You know,
like basketball.
Like, yeah. Yeah, and then they would do video on that and be like, Stave's lost his guy, and I'm like, it's called support and fucking. There's another way to do this.
The other guys are in the corner just being like, pitting the guy against the wall and being like,
"You not left, leave your guy that didn't matter and help me out when I fell."
You know, so it was just different everywhere.
What was the best? I obviously wasn't Russia, but when you were I'm saying, oh, Germany, we didn't get to that yet. But what was the best European country you played in? Like, if you had to go back and play in one more European country.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Lugano. Switzerland. Whoa, fuck, Helsinki was awesome.
Yeah.
Helsinki's a great
Helsinki
place.
Helsinki was awesome, you know.
I heard they love the heavy metal there.
Oh, they're big, Raskin's. Iron Maiden fans.
Yeah, big heavy metal.
Big, that's all we listen to.
Did you embrace the culture at all there?
No, I wasn't.
Speak English in Helsinki, you're a god.
Oh, yeah, yeah, no. Like, and that was easy because everyone spoke English too.
No, but if you were English, they would just like want to talk. They wanted to talk to you. They were just, am I right?
Well, you're white, so for me,
you're an Asian. They're like, get out of here,
dude. The guy, and when I
don't want to buy a purse.
Philippines Stapleton.
I know it's a fake purse.
I never really had much of an anger like in my career, you know. But when someone would call me like, "Hey, you fucking little Jap." Like they call me Chinese, I would get so like, I'm not fucking Japanese. Like that's what I would get like most mad because no one ever knows what I am. But I am Filipino. I'm Irish.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good mix.
And Russian.
And Russian.
All the gas.
Yeah.
So after Switzerland, you did a little stint in Sweden. Or am I reading that league wrong?
Yeah, I went to Sweden.
Oh, you were such a friggin' suitcase at the end, dude.
I played on 8 teams in 4 years.
Yeah, you.
I traded myself.
So maybe Keenan was right.
Yeah, maybe Keenan was right. I would buy Keenan a beer. Like, I want to get back to Keenan. Because he's actually a good guy. I would buy him a beer at the bar. Like,
I saw him at a charity event recently. But I'm obsessed with the fact, like, how can you turn it on to being such a fucking asshole?
Maybe he's sick in the head.
I mean, it worked. I mean, he was a successful. I'm not saying he was always successful.
That's
but he
just how it was, though, back
he
then.
Did like, win
he
did a lot.
He actually told me one of the best stories. He said that early in the 90s, they brought fucking. And this is, like, an example of, like, what guys would yell back at him, right? Like, the old school guys. But they brought, like, the Hawks to charity or training camp thing in, like, Banff or something. I don't know if you guys heard this story.
Yeah, no, I haven't.
They get away.
Yeah, and it was a ski resort. And Keenan's like, I'm giving this fucking speech to everyone. People brought their wives and girlfriends. And, you know, I got my wife. And I'm like, there's one fucking rule. No fucking skiing. I don't want anyone getting hurt. Da, da, da.
Is that a euphemism or actual skiing?
What's the 90s?
Ari does horny. Blow. I don't know if you knew.
Ari's like, wait, you skiing?
Yeah.
Like, hey, Keenan, you holding?
Keenan's like, so after, you know, we practice, he's like, so me and my wife go skiing. And we're like strolling down this ski hill. And he said, all of a sudden, two guys, one on each side, go bombing by me. Ski poles like laid out like they're fucking downhill racing. Jeans on. Fuck you, Keenan. It's Chelly and Ronick.
No way. No way. That's what
So that's, you know what I mean? Like that's like, so he, that's how
he
it
loves
was.
It.
That's how it was back in the day though, right? Yeah. So that's why his method was, that was his method. Dude, when he would yell at these fucking Russian guys, it was comedy. Because these Russian guys, these Russian guys would just, you know, that dumb look of just like, and Keenan would be like, Max, you fucking pussy, like fucking da da da, you know, and then Max is just sitting there like arm up, like hanging, like, you know, and then Keenan would walk out, and Max would be like, Tim, what do you say? And I'd be like, keep going, man, like, keep flying out there, Max, like, you know.
You're buzzing, dude.
My point
You're
is buzzing. Like,
he didn't have a Russian coach say stuff
he,
after.
That's why he fit no, well he in there, because he would just yell.
Exactly.
But he thought he was pumping him up. He was like, Tony Robbins.
Yeah.
He was Tony Robbins. They thought
all
he was
the Russian guys. This guy's the best.
He spit in their faces, and then he's like, "Wow, this guy
can do it."
But no, and that's why that's what I didn't understand at times. It was like, dude, no one's like this. This isn't gonna work. So stop yelling at me, A,
dude,
and B.
That is so funny.
Oh man, he was fucking. But that Chelly Ronick story is fucking. And maybe I'm quoting it wrong. So don't. But
duh.
That's
no. He told we don't give a shit. It's real.
No, that's
it's now real.
That's
it's just not real.
That's
real.
That's as real as feathers on a squirrel. So we're good.
Just blue jeans on.
So how do you
fucking pull?
Jabos.
Yeah, yeah.
Hilarious. How do you end up back in fucking Russia though? Like, how'd that play out?
Money.
No, it actually
got held hostage.
He's like, no, he's like, I need the gas.
I was playing, I was going through gas withdrawals and fuck. No, but I just, I don't know. I just wasn't, Sweden was tough for me.
Yeah.
Great country, but they fucking, I just went there and played like third line. And you know, at that time I was like, oh, I should be playing power play or something. You know, you want to play what you think you're, you know.
Right, right.
You know, it's not, and it was late in my career and that was kind of my mentality. And I figured like, well, fuck, if I'm going to hate playing, might as well do it in fucking Russia.
Get high every day.
You know? Where'd you go?
Dude, I actually liked Russia when I think
about it. Yeah, because you're a sicko deep down.
No, I was good. I went to Moscow.
Oh, so.
And that was awesome.
That'll work.
That was awesome. And we had Gilroy was on the team.
Oh, you were on Spartak?
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
Gilroy was money over there, dude.
In like 20 games.
Things didn't
These guys were like fucking. You talk about like your teammates just looking at you in disgust.
They hated you.
Well, yeah, I mean they probably did, but they were just like couldn't believe like how bad at hockey.
Not earning his gas.
Yeah, you know. No,
so then the last year, just you end up in Germany, and then that was
I started in the Swiss second league. Yeah.
How like
they were mad and I was leading the team in scoring and that league was like imports have 3 points a game. Like that's what they average. Like and then some of these guys and I just couldn't figure out how to play that kind of hockey. Like I wasn't a fucking
it's kind of all over the map.
Well, it's just like it's all like you if you have like any one-on-one skill like you can dominate cuz it's like, you know, it's the second league. Which wasn't bad. Guys can skate well and stuff, but it was just
more of individual efforts.
Yeah, and I need to play with other guys. My teammates. Like a lot of my good years, if you want to say that, it was I had really good lines. I mean, it's not like I was never a one-on-one. Yeah. You know, so over there they were like expecting me to like dangle around.
You're like, dude, I need some line mates, bud.
Yeah, I'm like, you know, exactly. And then I went to Germany. My coach from my very first year in Finland was a coach in Germany. And he's like, I'll put you in on the power play. And
that was a good way to end it.
He's got one of those globes in his house where he puts a needle every place he's been. You can't even see any water at this point.
Dennis maps.
He's the only guy that has a business in South Africa but hasn't been there.
No, the business is here. It's just a South African. All right, all right. Let's go back to that. Boyke's Biltong.
I know you weren't there.
Get it. Live ad read.
Boyke's.com. Yeah, you want me to do it?
Yeah, do a live ad read.
K-E-Y-S. B-O-I-K-E-Y.
Boyke's.
Boyke's. Chili Biltong.
Biltong.
Yeah. Tender slices of air-dried beef.
32 grams of protein.
Made in the USA. U.S. inspected and passed by the Department of Agriculture. That's a phantom. You guys definitely fucking...
First of all, it was tasty. You're telling me there's less sugar in that shit than there is in like
sugar in this.
Zero.
Yeah.
Zero grams of sugar.
0 grams.
What's
of sugar,
the most
half
negative?
The sodium.
Okay. What's the negative aspect? Half the amount of
half
sodium.
The sodium. Yeah. This stuff's like off the wall, like healthy. Yeah.
No.
We didn't know that until like a week ago.
My wife's like, no, my wife's like,
I'm like, wait a minute, this is healthy.
When you sent that, she like looked through it. She's like, wow, this stuff's actually really good for you. Like, cause if you grab some of the like the beef jerky and a gas station, you're like, dude, this
you started this or your buddy?
We both did.
Tell him we can get in talks for some swipe ups, a couple biz 20 promo codes.
Yeah. Stapes, dude, you're the man for coming on.
I did
want to tell one story.
Oh, let's go.
This might when people yeah, it's
this
Russian.
Is brought to you by Boinkies.
This is the story. This is the ad about Boinkies.
Yeah, go for it. And this is my favorite Russian story, and it's not like, you know, you guys talk about the everyday to day stuff, right? So in Minsk, there was an import player, Kevin Lalonde, goalie. Okay. And he was there for like 5 years, and I don't know if you know like Dazi, like when you play in these countries for a certain amount of, you know, years, they'll offer you a passport.
Yep,
like Dazi can play for like the Kazakhstan Olympic team. So Minsk was doing that. And so Kevin had a Belarus passport and a Canadian passport at the time. And, you know, the first month we get there, he gets his apartment. And he's got this, like, decent apartment, but he's paying, like, fucking almost $4,000 a month, which is a lot there. And he's paying it in cash to the landlord. You know, and the landlord, the first month he paid, the landlord came over. We met him. He came with his wife. Nice couple. And, you know, a few months go by, and as the season's going by, Kevin's all of a sudden got this thing going on where he thinks there's a ghost in his apartment. He's like, dude, there's a fucking ghost in my apartment, right? And I'm like, we're laughing about
whoever
it.
Whoever says it, you don't believe.
Yeah. He's just like, there's things being moved, and there's like this. And I'm like, well, dude, we are in fucking Belarus, whatever. Yeah. So January comes around, we go on this road trip, and we went to like Finland and Prague had a team, and then we were going into Russia, and Kevin forgot his Canadian passport. So like 2 days into this trip, he's like, fuck, I can't go to into Russia. So the team had to fly him back. So he comes back and he gets in at like 2 a.m. in Minsk, and he's got to get back on a flight in like 4 hours. So he gets to his apartment and he puts the key in, and he's going to open the door and it won't open. And he's like, fuck, am I at the right? He's like, yeah, I'm at the 23, and he hears a dog. And he's like, what the fuck? So, and then he realizes his door is like bolted from the inside. He's like, what the fuck? So he starts pounding on this thing.
Somebody's in there.
Dude, the door opens, and this guy opens the door, and he's got like, he's in his boxers, no shirt on. It's the fucking landlord. I swear to God.
When he was gone,
he was gone, he would move the family back in. Swear to God, he was charging this guy like $4,000 a month, and then we would go on these 10-day road trips, and he would move his. Kevin said he came in, the kid's sleeping on the couch. This guy's there, the wife's in his bed.
They got the family pictures up.
Swear to God,
So what did he do?
He said it. He
nothing.
Eventually that stopped, but he said at the time he's like, I couldn't process what was going on, so I was just like, we got to talk about this later. I need to get like 3 hours of sleep. So he's like, I'm walking to my room, and the guy's like, Kevin, can you use a spare bedroom? Like,
my wife's in there.
And then the best part about it was that Kevin was like, every month they always asked me about a cleaning lady, and it was always right before we went on the road. So they were also charging him.
They wanted it clean, yeah, too, clean, for when they went in.
No, after. So they would stay there and then get it clean, and Kevin had to pay for it all.
Oh, fucking double bubble.
That's incredible.
That's fucked. Fucking
yeah.
Quint
Vintage.
That's incredible.
And it's not like the funniest story, but it's just like fucking.
Yeah, that's.
For me,
yeah.
It's more like just
sums
like.
It up.
That's insane.
That's fucking.
Yeah, Russia.
That's Russia.
Well, that's a great way to end it, dude. Well, hey, Stapes, that was awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Legit one of the funniest.
Let's go have some dinner and tell some stories we can't tell on here, unfortunately.
Thanks. Hey, thanks for dinner, Stapes.
Well, we hope you guys enjoyed that interview. Thanks again to Boykies for their support of Spittin' Chiclets and the ECHL Player Relief Fund. Make sure to check out boykies.com and enter promo code BIZ20 for 20% off on all of their products. Woo!